Welcome to the Kandid shop. We speaking on things you not. Just press play and let it rock. Hey, welcome to the Kandid shop. Whoa. Welcome to the Kandid shop. We speaking on things you not. Just press play and let it rock. Hey, welcome to the Kandid shop. Whoa. Feel like we going through mad things. Gotta keep it real when they choose not. We gon' talk about it when the news drop. Welcome to the show where you know we don't fake this. Keep your opinion to yourself if it don't make sense.
Hola, Podcast Nation. It's your girls, Candidly Kristen and the Grounded Tyena, and this is the Kandid Shop. Welcome to part three of our Kandid discussion on mental health. Today, we're going to dive into mental health in minority and marginalized communities. We are waiting for our resident mental health professional to dial in. She couldn't find the link. But Anise McGriff, who is an outpatient psychotherapist and... Holds a master's degree in marriage and family therapy, is joining us right now. So we're going to get started, as we always do, with some stats. Okay, mental health disparities in diverse populations. Now, for the purposes of this conversation, we're going to be talking about African-American communities, Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders, Hispanics and Latinx, LGBTQ, American Indian, and then women, because we are counted as a minority. So just to give a general overview of where mental health percentages fall in those categories, for African Americans, 13.3% experience some mental health issue. Hispanic, Latinx, 17.8%, Asian, 5.7%, American Indian, 1.3%, and Pacific Islanders looks like only 0.2%. With white, Caucasian, and white, for the purposes of this discussion, is anybody that's non-Hispanic and not in any of those groups that I just mentioned. They, by far, 61.3%, have the larger numbers. But the funny thing is, while they have larger numbers of mental health issues, we get less care. So we want to talk a little bit about that today. We're going to try to touch on all the different cultures, but we only have an hour. So I'm going to turn this over to my co-host so I can cough. Excuse me.
Hi, Nina. Hey. How are you doing today?
Welcome, welcome. We missed you yesterday, girl. It was a good
yes.
one.
Yes.
Oh, I'm bummed that it was so bad. I literally had to make sure I was off at 6 o'clock for the rest of the week.
And girl, tomorrow I need you real bad. So don't play with me.
I will be here.
Okay. So listening to those numbers, we're going first, because this is the group to which I belong, talk about African Americans. I want to talk about the numbers. I want to talk about the barriers to mental health care, the stigma, cultural stigma, that African Americans as a whole, not everybody, so I'm not speaking about everybody that's Black, but just as a whole, have about mental health.
I want to say that I feel like that number, probably a portion of that, is underreported. Feel like our numbers are definitely low because of that stigma. Mm-hmm. But I want to also acknowledge the fact that I have been noticing it is becoming more and more normalized for our people, African Americans, to actually support one another when it comes to this mental health thing. And I'm even seeing younger and younger, let's say African-American males, who are supporting one another. I seen a young man on Facebook recently, and he was crying out. He was saying how it was something where it could have been interpreted as a suicidal ideation. And okay, a friend of his got on there, and he said, if you need to cry, he said, cry, bro. If you need to call me, call me. If you need to talk to someone. And these were young men.
I've definitely seen that.
Yeah, and I'm noticing that more, like, in the African-American community, we definitely have a lot of people who still say, oh, you don't need to talk to nobody, you know, go smoke something, go drink something, you'll be all right in the morning.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm. But we are becoming more and more okay with saying, go speak with someone.
We're becoming okay with not being okay.
There you go.
I think the younger generation gets it a little more than people. I'm 53. People my age and up kind of don't really understand this mental health thing. What do you mean? You got a mental health issue. You know what I mean? Take some Robitussin and ginger ale and go lay down.
Yep.
You know, get some sleep. Mm-hmm. So I have seen, and I've commented on when people say things that are, you know, borderline, like, wait a minute, what you mean? You don't really know why you here or stuff mm-hmm. like that. I have absolutely seen that kind of encouragement. But you know what I see a lot? You know, pray, God will get you. You know, God got you, da-da-da-da-da. And you know what my comment was? After you pray, call 211.
Yep.
And get mm-hmm. some help. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I absolutely do see that.
I have to agree with you on that, Kristen. I think religion is always brought up, you know, it's because you're not praying enough, you know,
yeah.
you're
right,
not
right.
on your knees enough, you know, and you know, not everybody necessarily has the same spiritual, you know, yeah. beliefs.
And listen, even if you do,
does rely on that, you know,
and even if you do, I'm a pray and I'm gonna ask God to help me find a mental health professional for me. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because it can't just be you gonna pray away schizophrenia. You're not.
Hello. This is Sassy hey, Susie.
Hello there, Sassy hey, Susie. Sassy. Welcome, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. So
we're talking now too, also with the as far as like the age gap is.
Mm-hmm.
When you were younger, mental health one wasn't a really big thing. It wasn't big. And back right. then, you were taught to keep people out of your business. What happens in yes. that house stays in that
yeah.
house.
Yeah, oh my God, we were just talking about that.
Like, don't yeah, you say a word, word. You know?
Mm-hmm. You know, now mm-hmm. it's almost shoved down, you know, or like, if you need help, get help. It's on TV. We got billboards. We have other mm-hmm. people that, you know, that are in our lives that say, mm-hmm. if you need help, get it. But mm-hmm. when you have people that have grew up in years and years of keep people out your business, you know, like mm-hmm. they don't know what's best for you. Those people, when you have statements like that and you grew up accustomed to that, you're not going to want to talk to me or anyone else because I'm going to be in your business.
Mm-hmm.
I'm right. going to be the person that calls someone for your family.
Right.
And that's what a lot of people are people sometimes. I'm even working with families where I have to get that division out.
Okay, yeah.
Because
yeah.
they have that stigma. It's like, okay, if I'm associated with something bad.
Yes, it absolutely is. A huge stigma. We're talking about specifically minority and marginalized communities, but in general, it's a stigma. But for minority communities, it's like a double stigma. We're not only burdened with social and economic disparities. We're mm-hmm. distrusting. We're distrusting of government, mental yeah. health, mm-hmm. medicine, doctors, period. And when none of them look like you, mm-hmm. it's difficult for you to sit down and unburden yourself to them when you feel like they have no clue of what my lived experience is.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say that was my experience with the one time I did see the therapist. She was a Caucasian lady, and I didn't think she really would understand the issues that I was going through or how I was raised and the experiences that I had been through. I didn't think that she would understand that. So that's part of the reason why I stopped going to her, because I didn't feel like there was a connection.
Were you able to have that communication, that dialogue with her to let her know how you felt? Or did you
I think I was afraid to tell her how I felt, and I didn't want to hurt her feelings.
You know what's funny? Mm. On Monday, I think I actually said to you guys that when I meet with my clients, I have a big thing where I ask them about their comfortability. Mm-hmm. I actually had a Caucasian client. And 2 weeks into our session, I had a meeting with her and my supervisor. And I mm-hmm. told my supervisor before we spoke with her, I did not feel like I could assist this woman. I was not the mm-hmm. right professional for her. I was.
Right.
You have to be, as a professional, as a mental health professional, okay to say I cannot assist this person. Give okay. her or him to someone that is better equipped
mm-hmm. to meet their needs.
She should have yes. never felt like she couldn't come to her therapist and say, you know, I get it, this is okay, but I don't feel like this is the right fit. can you put me to somebody who may better be able to assist me?
All right, I'm going to just ask for a timeout. Somebody's phone is buzzing. I don't know if you're getting notifications through your phone, but they're coming through.
If you can mute it for me.
Or turn that off. And
we have Jen in
the room.
There
it go again. I was going to say we have Jen as a caller. Jen, you are a licensed social worker. Am I correct?
Yes.
Awesome. So
hi, Jen. Welcome.
Hi, thank you.
Yes,
welcome. I'll randomly mute because I do have the baby in the background.
That's okay, but feel free to interject. Whose phone is that now?
That's mine, and I'm trying to turn it off. Sorry.
Oh, Lord. Somebody blowing you up, girl.
Listen.
Lord.
Yeah.
Mute no, it's the notification.
Okay.
Yeah, mute yourself while you're doing that, and you can come back in.
Yeah. There so I'm reading this, and I shared this with my podcast partner, and they didn't really expand on it, but I'm hoping that my professionals in the room can maybe help me understand. This says that African Americans' depressive occurrences are more disabling, persistent, and resistant to treatment than those similar occurrences experienced by whites. They didn't really, it was kind of in a did you know kind of infograph. And I really would love to deep dive into that. Maybe not today. But what do you, first of all, do you think that's an accurate statement? And second of all, if it is, why is it?
I don't feel like that's accurate.
No.
Based upon my experiences, I've had clients from both spectrums, and I've had clients from both that have dealt with the same issues. Mm-hmm. However, I've had African American clients that were able to climb out of that hole where I may have had to do just maybe a little bit more work with the Caucasian one. So I do feel like it's a situational case-by-case basis. I don't feel like that's accurate.
Do you think it might be health insurance, socioeconomic disparities that make it more disabling, persistent, and resistant to treatment? Is it because, minority populations don't have access to the same level of care?
I think that
I'm just putting it out there.
No, I think that does play a part. Because on Monday, we were actually talking about that. It's the difference where if you have a private insurance and you go to your private doctor and your private doctor then refers you to a private therapist and things of that nature versus you going to a clinic and then when you call your insurance card, they give you a cluster of places that you can go to talk to someone.
Okay.
But it's not within your network. It's not a team approach. It's not a team approach.
Okay. Gotcha.
So the other thing that makes sense.
Go ahead, Jen.
I'm seeing that I've learned throughout schooling was the stigma that goes along with therapy.
Absolutely.
Where you have, I'm Caucasian myself, but you have certain families that'll say what's done in the house stays in the house. What's said in the house stays in the house. Don't you dare go talk to somebody else.
Yeah, we just talked about that.
So
absolutely.
I see that too more in other cultures than I would say in my own.
So Jen, let me ask you a question. Mm-hmm. As I hate the word Caucasian.
White. You can,
white.
Yeah, right.
Okay. I hate all of it. But do you think that you can adequately help someone from another culture? Do you think that just because you're not African American or Asian or Hispanic that you can help them just based on your experience?
Well, the struggle too of you're white, you have no idea how I feel. You grew up like I have two parents that are still together that have great jobs.
Right.
You know what I grew up, I never had issues. I was never abused. So that plays a role where when I do therapy, I'm very forthcoming and I don't mind sharing some of my stories. So I don't know if it's appropriate or not. So I would love some of your feedback, but I am married to a Black man and we have a mixed child.
Okay. So girl, you Black. Listen. You Black. Wait a minute. Girl.
So what kind of lines do you serve? Like what population?
Right now, I just started a new job actually because I just had a baby last year and unfortunately was laid off from my job during Corona. Okay. So I started a new job in March where now I work at a high school. But previous to this, I worked at for Catholic Charities, which I'm sure everybody's heard of. And I served many different populations with Catholic Charities.
Now, is your high school is it diverse or predominantly white, black?
It's diverse, I would say. It's mostly white, but there are they're trying to integrate other people. I hate that word. It actually happened. It actually happened in my town. I live in a small town in upstate New York, so no, I don't live in a city.
At least they're trying. I like to hear the trying.
Yeah, so that actually happened when I was in high school, where there was different neighborhoods, and so actually when I was put into middle school, I had to travel like a half an hour to my middle school just so they could integrate white people, white kids in with the mixed population. So that's something my brother and I had to do when we were younger. So they're still trying that up here. Like, I'm not gonna lie to you, I live in a town right now where there's Amish people with horse and buggies that drive down my street.
Nice.
So it's very interesting. My husband's from Brooklyn and he's a rapper, and so him like it's very interesting for him to live up here. He enjoys it very much, but
he needs the city sometimes.
he does go to the city sometimes. I do use that, and again, I want your opinion. I have his pictures, I have my daughter's pictures in my office.
As you should. So that's your husband.
So sometimes if I have a black girl that comes in my office and she's like, you're not going to understand anything about me. I might not have personally gone through some of those things, but I do use that as a little like leeway, like, hey, I'm not as white as you think I am.
I don't think there's anything wrong with that at all. What you're showing is that, you know, I might not have experienced what you experience, but I'm not going to judge you for it. And I don't see necessarily any color barriers between you and I, because here's my child and here's my husband. And and I'd like to think that they might be a little more comfortable when you share. Share that with somebody. So they can understand that your whole world isn't whitewashed in a sense.
And the reality is, mental health doesn't see color. It doesn't care if you're black or white or brown or yellow or purple. Schizophrenia is schizophrenia. So if we're looking at treating the issue, then let's treat the issue. Now, do you need to be culturally sensitive? Absolutely. You know what I mean? But I don't think that not being the same color as someone is necessarily a barrier to helping them.
It's a barrier to helping, but at sometimes, like I think that was just mentioned, it's a barrier in building the relationship. Like, you're not helping them until you build rapport with them. So for me, I feel like, I mean, I have a 16-year-old black girl that wants to come in my office and talk to me. I'm going to start out with like, hi, how are you? Look at my face. Like, this is my family. This is my husband. I want to make her feel comfortable. Like, this girl lives with a black man. You know what I mean? There have been women.
Like, that works for you?
I was going to say, because that could backfire.
Do you feel like that's worked thus far?
It has backfired.
Really?
With older black women that don't like the fact that I have a black husband.
That you took one of the black men away from us.
So yes, in a sense it has. I think it works better for me with kids. Than it does with the adult population. I've had white people not want to work with me because I'm married to a black man.
So, and you know what?
I have separate offices where I have the office that I have in the high school itself. I have my pictures around in the office. So I also work out of a clinic at night, and in that office, I do not have pictures.
That's interesting.
Yes, and I want to hear more about that, please.
So for that reason, because adults seem to be more judgmental.
Than
a child, where a child coming in to talk to me, hi, I'm Jen. I never go by I'm Mrs. So-and-so. Like, no, I'm Jen. You can call me Jen. And yes, I may work in your school, but this is who I am. Let's sit down. I play cards. Like, this is who. And so I feel comfortable having my pictures, because then they'll ask me, oh, who is that? And then I'll say my husband. And then they warm up a little bit more if I'm talking to them. Whereas the adult population, I don't share as much. Or
I have a question for you for that. Mm-hmm. What does that do to your mental? Knowing that you go to this place.
Good question.
Yeah, and you cannot be basically who you are. Mm-hmm. Or stand on who your family is. What does that do to you?
Because you're being discriminated against as a professional because of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
I try not, because I'm a professional, I don't let it bother me that I know that there's underlying things that they have to work on as their selves in order for me to build that relationship with them. So, again, I'm non-judgmental towards anybody. I don't care if you're black, brown, purple, yellow, whatever. I'm non-judgmental. I don't care. I've worked in a prison before, and I've had full-blown murderers sitting in front of me, and my jaw didn't drop to the floor when they told me their story. I'm definitely tell me who you are, how you feel, how do I make you feel, if you're, and I'm the same way. Like, if you're comfortable, you're comfortable. If you're not, please, by all means, let me know, and I can find you somebody else.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to cut you off, right? I'm sorry, guys. I just heard you tell me, and this is not a therapy session, guys, I'm sorry, but heard you tell me everything that you do for everyone else, how you accommodate everyone else, Jen. Mm-hmm. Literally, you just told us that you accommodated everyone else, right? Mm-hmm. But when I go back to that question, what about you?
I need somebody to mute themselves that's walking around or sweeping.
No, I'm standing still, guys.
Okay.
All right, go ahead.
Yeah, but no, I want to know, Jen, like, what do you do?
I do struggle with my own self-care. But right now, again, I took this position. It's not the greatest paying position, but I picked it because I am a first-time mom, and I had a new baby. I had an awful pregnancy. So I picked this position because of the agency, and they're so very caring. And my supervisor is so supportive. I have a male supervisor. He's amazing. And I can tell him anything. And I've only been with him since March. So that's kind of right. Like, I had a supervision, to me, is my self-care.
Okay, cool. So let me ask you this, Niecy and Jen, as mental health professionals, so you get a new client, you meet them for the first time. So say it's not a white person or African-American, it's somebody Hispanic or Asian. What's the method for, I guess, ice breaking, or in your initial conversations with them? You know, because you can't, you know, Jen, you do have a black husband, but you don't have an Asian one or a Hispanic one. Right. So you know what I mean?
So is your approach different depending on the race culture or ethnicity?
For me, my approach is the same across. When I get a new client, I get an eval. I don't even go through the entire eval. And I don't go through the eval because I don't want what I read to determine what I think about that person.
Got you.
That is exactly what I do.
Yeah, I tell everybody, I don't read it because I don't care what we say. When we read that, we are now interpreting.
We form opinions.
Mm-hmm. Yep,
we form opinions.
I don't. I get basic information, and I meet with that person, and we have that session is for both of us to get to know one another. You ask me questions, I'm going to ask you questions to get the paperwork.
Yep. Absolutely.
Just a session. Yeah. It's a dialogue. That's all that's how I approach all my clients.
Mm-hmm. Me too.
Awesome.
Absolutely. All right. So, Niecy, the majority of your clients, what is their ethnicity or their race or their background? The majority?
The majority, I will say, African American.
Okay.
And for you, Jen, is it a mixture or?
Right now, predominantly white.
Okay. Well, let me ask both of you, have you had occasion to have clients? Now, this episode is predominantly about adults, and I know both of you guys work with children. That's tomorrow. But do you have occasion to work with members of the LGBTQ community?
Oh, yes.
Yep.
Okay.
Both of you?
Yes.
And how is that different?
It's not.
It's not.
Not at all. Not at all.
Okay. All right, awesome.
I think it's just, again, that initial, like Niecy just said, the initial, the first day, I put my pen and paper down. Like, yes, I know we have a lot of paperwork to do in the intake process and signing papers and blah, blah, blah. But literally, like, the first half hour, I'm literally like, okay, hi, I'm Jen. Who are you? Tell me about you.
Right.
And then I let them ask me questions. Like, if you want to know if I'm married, if you, you know, like, sometimes I might, like, not... If, I mean, I've had child molesters before. I'm not going to come out and tell you I have a baby. Right. You know, so,
no matter what color you are.
Right. There are certain things that I share and certain things that I don't. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Right. So, but other than that, you know, it's kind of like, go ahead if you want, if you feel that asking me questions is going to make you more comfortable. I'm not just going to sit here and stare at you. I'll answer what I feel comfortable answering.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I have a question for both of you. Did I lose it? I think I lost it. It was good too. It was very good. Okay, here it comes. Okay, so when you have a client come in, where do they usually come from? Do you usually hear somebody forced me to be here? My doctor told me to come. My mother's forcing me to come. What is the majority? Of people coming from, is it from their primary care doctor? Is it a family member? You go first.
So for me, when I work with adults, a lot of them are actually walk-ins. People that walked in, like from the neighborhood or family members that may have told them about the facility I work for, a lot of walk-ins. Now, my children come from
Hold on, Niecy, I want to ask you a question. Are your walk-ins predominantly male or female?
Actually, they're both. I can say it's a 50-50 split.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
And for a lot of them are referral based from hospitals.
Okay.
My children.
How about from courts? Do either of you have clients that it's required?
Not my adults. I had two court orders.
Okay. Okay. And Jen?
How about you, Jen?
Yeah. So. I would say for my adults also, it's predominantly not walk-ins. We have a wait list for my agency, but they contact the agency. They want counseling. And so it's based out of towns. Again, I told you I'm in a little town. So there's a ton of our little towns. So they'll say, like, I want to be in such and such town. So then they get put on the wait list. It's mostly.
So like a wait list for mental health care to me is awful. Because. Your issue can't wait.
No.
They're actually worse now.
What, the wait list?
Do you think that that's because of the COVID?
It is. It is. Yep. We have so many therapists because of COVID.
Yep.
I have so many clients on the wait list. I have parents, children, just on a wait list and at three different agencies because we are so short therapists.
Wow.
Yeah, I was going to say, it sounds like a lack of therapists.
Mm-hmm. That's what it is.
And the hours.
And is it because therapists don't want to come in the office or there just aren't enough qualified? I mean, do we need to be training up more therapists?
What I'm hearing is they don't want to come back to the office. In a lot of the smaller communities, right, these therapist offices are a little hole in the walls. Okay. We got little offices that we go in. No windows, no ventilation, anything like that. Mm-hmm. So they don't want to be in these closed in spaces.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. You know, with who knows?
Yeah.
Right.
I get it. But for the client who's really like reaching out and they hear, I can put you on the wait list.
Yeah.
I mean, even though there are crisis numbers and stuff you can call, like when you need help, you need help. That's right, just like calling 911 and going, oh, I gotta put you on the waiting list. That's bad.
It's kind of sad though, because when you're seeking help and you actually have that momentum to go out and actually contact somebody and reach somebody to only be denied that help.
Absolutely.
Especially how hard it is to take that first step.
Listen, especially in the communities that we're talking about, the minority and marginalized communities, just to get to fight through your whole family to say, listen, I don't care what y'all say, I'm going to get some help. You know, you had to deal with all that, and now you finally taking that step and waitlisted. That's, mm-hmm. you know.
You know, to be honest, I've never heard that there was a waitlist for mental health.
It is.
Me not knowing, I always thought that, you know, like they say, they have the 1-800 suicide number. Mm-hmm. You can call 211 and you can get a list of all these different agencies.
Yep.
Right, but then to actually call and not be able to get the help, I can't really even fathom what that person must feel or be going through at that moment. Mm. It's almost ludicrous.
It is. Yeah. It's a level of frustration and, in a sense, denial that they feel. It's like, yeah. I'm not good enough. Or if I was somewhere else. Go ahead.
So the waiting list would be like if in a clinic setting or more of a private setting?
Clinic.
Clinic,
for sure.
So,
but
so
again, it goes back to afford. To stick up for us. Is it Nisi, I think, the other therapist in here?
Mm-hmm.
There's times, don't you think that we come home and wish that we wanted to help everybody?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
I'm going to go back to that self-care piece of like, sometimes I have to say no. I 6 o'clock, my day ends. I have to go home. I have a baby that goes to bed at 7:30, 8 o'clock.
It's hard when you love your job. Mm-hmm. When it's something that you want to do, it's hard.
And you guys aren't the only two. There's lots of therapists out there. I think the entire mental health care system needs to change so that we don't have wait lists. If I can't find you a permanent therapist, everybody that calls in for help should get help, period. Mm-hmm. I don't know what that would look like practically, but...
Yeah, but you need the therapist in order to be able to handle the volume.
Yeah.
I mean, we have a lot of mental health issues, and especially in this country.
I wish I had stats on how many mental health professionals there are currently. I wish I did, but I don't. Darn it.
I have a question. Is there help for therapists when they are going through things? Like, how do you guys do?
I'm glad you said that. So, we do have numbers that they give us, right? Where we can call and talk to somebody over the phone.
Do y'all get waitlisted?
We can, because we don't really have anybody. But this, I want to come up with my own clinic for therapists. Because what people fail to realize is, right, if I work an 8-hour day, I didn't see 8 or 9 people, right? 8 or 9 people dumped all of their stuff
all
on me, right?
Yeah.
And then I go home to my family. My family dumps all of their stuff on me.
Right.
When does Nisi dump her stuff?
Mm-hmm.
We don't dump. Mm-hmm. We take everybody's stuff, but we're supposed to be okay at the end of the day.
And nobody be able to really give quality care.
There you go.
Right.
Oh, yeah. We get home and my husband's you'll never guess what happened today.
So wait a minute. What I'm hearing is that the mental health professionals are part of this marginalized community.
Correct.
You guys are not getting the care you need to give the care that you need to give.
Absolutely not. And we're also not okay with saying that we're not okay. You don't really hear us say that.
No. Uh-huh. Oh, really?
Uh-huh.
Huh.
Well, that's part of what we were reading there. We're all women on this panel at the moment.
The numbers, and because women are counted in this minority and marginalized group.
All right. So about 36% of women compared to men, which is 25%, suffer from anxiety disorders, right? And depression disorders. It's a very high number. But when you listen to our therapist on the panel, you know, they don't have their own outlet. You know, it's a choice and it's a job. But that doesn't mean it doesn't affect you. You know, any job that you do is going to affect you in some way, whether it be your back hurting, you're mentally just exhausted from the day or whatever the case may be.
But your job in particular.
Last night, yesterday we had a suicide.
Yeah.
So for me to come, my husband's like, what's wrong with you? And I'm like, I had a bad day. I might be cranky today, but it wasn't my time or professionally okay for me to be like, oh, so-and-so committed suicide today. Like we don't get to come, like he can come home and say, Joe, Billy and so-and-so did this to me at work. I can't come home and be like, guess what my client told me today.
Exactly. Right. You can't, right?
Right.
So
Think of the clients that we actually become close with. when you you develop these relationships with these people. Yes, they're clients. Yes, they come and they dump. But we develop. Sometimes you see these people for a year, 2 years, 5 years. You develop relationships. So yeah, we can't come in the house and tell you guys what's going on. But we also got to internalize and deal with the death of a client.
Yeah,
I agree. I can resonate with that. I used to be a nursing assistant for the elderly, right? And I created relationships with some of them. And you know, some mornings you would come in and, you know, they're gone overnight. And I would be sad for a couple weeks. You know what I mean? And, you know, for somebody else, it's like, oh, you do this every day. You know, what's the matter? You know what I mean?
Listen.
No, like you look for those certain little faces that always, you know, slide you a little piece of stale candy in the morning.
Right. and not for nothing, I work with an elderly population, and I know that this might be their last stop. It doesn't make it hurt any less when I lose them.
No, it sure doesn't. So. It sure doesn't.
I used to work in a, before I got my master's degree, I worked in a nursing home for 5 years.
Toughest job you'll ever do.
Yeah, so you know what we're talking about. Yeah.
That's why I went and got my master's, because I said I don't ever want to work in healthcare ever again.
It's rough. It's rough.
It's really rough.
And as the social worker, I mean, yes, I give 7,000 credits to CNAs and nurses. You couldn't pay me enough to do their job, and they don't make peanuts.
They don't make nothing.
But was times where there wasn't family and they were busy. I mean, like you have 4 CNAs and 40 residents. So there was times where I've held hands as they took their last breath because they didn't have anybody else to do it.
Right. Yeah. That was horrible. I hated those times where and I used to think like, gosh, nobody is really coming to see her. Like nobody.
Yes. Yeah.
They just dumped them there, you know?
I think that was my most draining job.
What I'd like to spend our last, you know, 15, 20 minutes talking about is ways to smash the barriers, the cultural barriers that prevent people from getting the help they need, the way that therapists, social workers, the people that are given the help can better help them. And I'm not a mental health professional. I'm here just facilitating. That's what I do.
But I think it starts with the community. I think it starts with them. Yeah. I mean, we sit here and say that, you know, the judgmental and all that. But what do you think? Do you think I'm not judged just by my profession? You know, so I mean, just that in itself makes me the bad person. Or, oh, you want to talk to me about my kids because you want to call CPS and take them away from me.
All right. Okay. Mm. Yeah.
Or you're just doing it because you get to build the insurance company.
Right.
Oh, there's you're here for the paycheck. I'm like, huh? If you saw my paycheck, you would know I'm definitely not here for the paycheck.
Never pays enough.
No. So, I mean, I think it starts with, to answer your question, it starts with getting it out there that we're not bad people and we're not judgmental, and you can, anybody in the world can come talk to me. And
like I'm here to help you.
Absolutely. And I think
we're starting to get there.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to be good. Because when you have years of people putting, you know, a certain profession down and it's frowned upon, we have to give that time to build up. And I think we're starting to see it now. And we're starting to see it with our younger generation.
So what,
I wanted to add, I've been through therapy a good part of my life from, you know, time I was a child, from teenager to adulthood. I have to say I was very resistant to it. And I used to, the first thing I would do is just sit there and cross my arms like, you can't help me, you know, like you've never been in my situation. It does happen. You know what I mean? And
so
Annette,
for you, what was the thing that broke your resistance that made you say, you know what, this person really, you know, she funny looking or whatever, but you know, she's giving me good stuff. You know what I'm saying? What was that thing?
I think it was one day I kind of applied the tools that most of my therapists were males, white males.
Okay.
I had one African-American female therapist, and that's when I was an adult. So they were mostly white males. And as a young female, I was like, hey, what the hell does he know about me? You know what I mean? But I applied, I was in a situation and like what he told me kind of clicked in my head. So I applied it and I was kind of taken aback, like,
Because it worked.
It worked. It worked. You know what I mean? And I was shocked, like, oh, that damn Dr. Richter. Like, he was right, you know? And then from there, you know, I trusted him a lot more. But it took a long time. It did. It took a long time.
So what her, what she said was, what took the longest was her accepting it.
Correct.
Yes. He was doing the work.
And I mean, he was doing the work.
That's mm-hmm. what it is. We have to accept that just because a person doesn't look like me,
exactly,
they might be able to help me.
Right.
That's the barrier right there. We go in and we see, all right, what can this white man tell me? What can he tell me about my hair? That's how we go into it. If we
can, I apply a lot of things that he has taught me, actually, you know, and my attitude was different when I came back in, and he was like, why are you so happy today? And it was more or less because I trust you now.
Yeah, right.
Now, I trust you.
Here's
now.
The follow up question.
Talk, you know,
here's the follow up question. You said it took a lot of time because I'm trying to see what the minimal therapy timeline should look like, because is it a week, a month, 2 months, six months minimum?
I would have a year's worth at 45 minutes twice a week is what my program
that's a lot.
A lot of people cannot
afford
actually
that.
Agree to it. Not even afford, agree to mm-hmm. it. Well, no, I'm going to say that, Chris. One thing. All right, so the 2 times a week, right? If you have that state mm-hmm. insurance, you get an hour a week. You can't, don't call me a second. If you were to call me for a second session within that week, I then have to go to my supervisor and explain why I feel like you need a second session in 1 week. Mm-hmm. That's how terrible mm-hmm. that is.
Okay.
So you see this thing private. Now, family base is private, right? It's a little different.
Okay.
I can hold as many sessions with my clients now as I want to.
Okay. Can I add to that, Niecy? Because listen to me. Niecy is exactly right, because I was a ward of the state. I was a foster child, right? Mm. So what Medicaid would cover would be one thing, and then my parents would have to pay for the other one.
Gotcha. You're adopted
parents. Just so you know, my adopted parents, right? That's how I got, you know, a little more than was offered, you know. I guess my parents' fingers, she needs a little bit more.
Got it. Well, it worked because you're awesome now, so.
It's because I trust and I use my tools. That's all you can do, you know. But it takes a long time, you know, to trust.
Yes.
Especially depending on what your trauma issues, what your issues are.
Right. You know? So
if you originally come in with trust issues, Kristen, that's the hardest. The hardest patient to deal with. Yeah. Right? Yeah. Do you agree, Niecy? Like, she already has trust issues. It's going to take me like a year.
So what did he do? Did he just talk to you? There was the hour passed, and he was like, you know, I know you probably don't think any of this means anything, or any of that, but if you just, and he just gave you the tools and let you go?
He would, he was so relatable, right?
Okay.
He was cool. He didn't use big words that I couldn't understand.
Okay. Got you. Mm-hmm. Got
you. You know, he always gave me things in layman's terms. And he just made me feel comfortable. I felt he was genuine. Like, he truly cared. He wasn't there for a check, you know?
Okay.
He used to take me outside. You know, we used to walk around and talk. It wasn't always like the same thing with him. You know what I mean? There was times where I would come in and he would have like a card game, and I'd be like, well, this is weird. And he's like, no, come on, we're going to play cards and we're going to talk. You know what I mean? So he was really good at what he did.
Go ahead,
Niecy. You can't expect people to come in there and just want to sit in the office and talk to you.
No.
Let's go for a walk. Let's do the thing that you don't typically do.
You like ice cream? Point, let's go get some ice cream.
Mm-hmm. You get tired of sitting in that same room.
Mm-hmm. It's intimidating.
Too much. Yep.
It's intimidating.
Okay. Right.
It's like when they tell you, when you chastise a child, you get down to their level. You never scream at them, you know, while you're towering them.
Yep.
Right? So it's kind of the same thing. It's, you know, coming down to my level, understanding that I'm vulnerable in this, you know, at this time, you know. Last thing I need is some big words in this stuffy, cold room
environment,
you know, with
all
your little fancy certificates and stuff that I don't give a shit about, you know?
Right.
One of my favorite parts of my new job now is that we can dress down. Which is absolutely amazing. And that helps. Like, I will rock some bright pink Converse sneakers and jeans.
Okay.
Yes, Jen.
And they love it. You know what I mean? Like, for me to go in, like, especially with kids and teens, they're coming in and I'm like dressed with heels and a dress, they're like, but if I'm rocking like sneakers and jeans and a t-shirt, they're going to come in and be like, oh, right. Okay. And so
let me ask you a question, Jen. And because you sound like you're 12, and I don't want to put you out there, but how old are you?
37.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. No, but Jen is right because he used to wear jeans and like a t-shirt and some sneakers. And his sneakers looked like he had them for like 55 years. You know, wasn't anything. You know, he didn't come
in with a bow tie. Did that make you feel more comfortable with him?
It did. I felt like he was more down to earth. He wasn't. Right.
Like,
it
imagine
wasn't
if
like
he walked in, he was in a suit.
Right. Mm, it's more. Yeah. It's more like a corporate situation when they're in a suit and tie and in a crisp setting. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's too formal. Agreed. Yeah. Exactly. Too formal.
I think that has a lot to do with it too. When we're coming off the street and now we have to deal with, you know, some professional that has a 3-piece Armani suit, is like he's not going to want to hear my shit. You know,
he's just gonna be looking at his watch like, you got 45 minutes.
I've personally walked out of a therapy session before for myself. I've gone to therapy. It was my first session with, so this was me going to a therapist. I didn't get to pick her, so it was kind of chosen for me. And I went, and she was, I'm on the overweight side. I've always have been my whole life. It's been a struggle with me. So I walked in. Here is this like 100-pound, tall, gorgeous, blonde hair, blue eyed. She was wearing like one of those like pencil skirts. I'll never forget it. And I was like, I'm like, oh, geez, this is gonna be great. So but I gave it a chance because I want people to give me a chance too, because they can come and be like, here's this fat lady.
Right.
So I gave her a chance. So here I am, and it was the first session, and we're chatting away, and I'm telling her my story. I'm crying like I had something happen to me back
now, Jen, when you were, this is as an adult, this was this therapy session,
so
or
I
as
was
a child?
24.
Okay. You were an adult. Okay.
And I was already a social worker. I graduated at 21 with my bachelor's in social work. Wow. So I was already in the field, and I had something personally happen to me where my boss told me that I should probably get counseling for it. So I did. Okay. So here I was spilling my guts, and I ended up crying, and she gave me a tissue, and she sat in silence for a little bit. No joke. First thing out of her mouth, have you ever considered going to a gym?
What?
No, she didn't. Yeah.
I swear to God. So I stood up and I was like, you will never see me again. And I walked out.
You didn't flip
she would have, first of all, she'd have got
bird?
Cussed all the way out for Phil.
All the way.
And then I would have left.
Exactly.
You should have where it hurt.
You that's right. You tell her, Jen, you should have ate 3 burgers before you came. Lady.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So
I'm so sorry.
But that experience for me helped me of what not to do.
Shape your practice how you do.
Yes. Because as humans, we're instantly going to judge people. So I might get judged on this fat girl in this white girl or whatever. So can judge me. So I need to be as cool and use my personality. And again, wearing jeans and looking comfortable and being down to earth.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It matters. It does matter.
Now I know like what not to say and what like, so you're having issues. Have you thought about going to the doctor? Like, no, I'm not going to say that.
Right. Right.
So she did help me in a way become a professional.
In a way. Yes, she did. Like,
what
she
not
did.
To do. but yes, so I have walked out of therapy before.
Okay. And that's fine.
So, Niecy, do you wear your Armani suit to work?
No, you know, I'm not going to lie to y'all.
I know you sharp. You.
I do like to get dressed and I wear my hoods and stuff. Now, I don't overdo it, but my clients, I used to get a lot of compliments, and that's what made me keep up that appearance. But I would dress down. Let's not get messed up. I get my jeans, my cute little.
Okay.
I dress down, too. But I never wanted to make it seem like I was better than the population.
Better than, exactly.
Right. Yeah. I never wanted to feel that way. Because, like, it's intimidating to go to someone else, and I'm dressed in, let's say, a $300 shirt. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. They look at that like, okay, maybe I don't want to tell this lady everything about me.
Right.
Right.
You know,
especially if a kid is sitting there with beat up shoes and clothes that he had to borrow or she had to borrow, or if it's an adult, they're homeless. maybe haven't had a shower.
There's nothing like social worker that comes to pick you up and take you someplace else in a 3-piece suit. It's like it feels like the government. Right. Yes. You know what I mean? It's come to snatch you up. Okay. You know, I used to like the caseworkers that, you know, dressed down and stuff, you know, and had their little hat on or their little sneakers on. I felt more comfortable getting the car, but when it looks like the FBI is coming to get you,
right?
You know, it's scary. It's scary.
Right. Yeah.
True, I think as humans, we're visual, right? Mm-hmm. We don't really know anybody until you have a conversation with them. Absolutely. So it's all visual in the beginning. You know, even when you meet a guy, it's like, oh, he's cute until you find out that, you know, he's a jerk as soon as he opens his mouth, you know?
Right.
And then we also have to think about the kids' mentality of, like you're saying, of how they look at people.
Mm-hmm. Well, wait a minute now, y'all. Listen. The children is tomorrow. We talking about adults today.
Oh, adults. Okay.
18 and up. 18 and
I got to make sure to call in tomorrow.
Yes, that's going to be a really good one.
Jen, this is us tomorrow.
This is all y'all tomorrow.
We taking over tomorrow.
Yeah, I'm going to just be here so I don't get fined and watch the clock. That's all.
We pretty much have to break the stigma to, it doesn't matter whether you're Black, white, or Asian. As a therapist, as a social
gay,
worker,
straight, bi, you know, curious, whatever.
What you guys, your job is to get us better, right? Get
to heal
better, you know,
and
heal.
To give you tools
mm-hmm.
to get, because you shouldn't have to be in therapy your whole life. Like, you can go in and out, but your therapist isn't giving you tools to manage life without them, then they're not doing their job. Like, there should be a point where you're like, I don't think I need to come here no more. But if I need you, I know your number, though, right? You know what I'm saying? Right. Because you've given them the tools to effectively manage stress and conflict, whatever their issue is.
Yeah. As an adult, my therapist I thought we were going to have a talk, and he was kind of releasing me. And I was like, what?
Wait, what? So
I started off not. Yeah, not wanting to go. And then I was distraught. I was like, you
didn't
want to
leave.
He's like, I just want you to know that you're okay. You just have to trust yourself. I'm like, trust myself? What is that? You know? But when I tell you, I cried for like 3 days. And I was like, he left me. You know, but
can I make you feel better?
That's the other side of it. That people don't really realize. Sometimes people become dependent on the therapist.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And he told me, He pretty much told me, Annette, you answer your own questions. You just have to trust yourself. You know, he's like, there's nothing else I can do with you, because you literally sit here and you answer your own questions. Yep. The only thing you lack is the confidence, you know?
Right.
So I had to
know
work
that
on
the
that.
Answers are right. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And look at you now, boo.
Therapy, go ahead, Jen.
A question, or you'll say something, and then they'll be quiet and look at you. And then you turn around and, like you just said, answer the exact, you tell yourself already what needs to be done.
Yep. Right. It's the truth. Yep.
I just reiterated for you. That's all.
That's it.
Go ahead, Jen. You wanted to.
Yeah, I just want to make you feel better. The discharge process, 98% of the time, gives us just as much anxiety as it gives you.
Yep.
You think he missed me? Oh,
yes.
That's good to know.
Yeah. No, really. Like, I hate it. Even if it's an awful quiet and I'm like, oh my God, I can't wait to get rid of it. It's still,
I agree, Jen.
Absolutely. Like, I have just as much anxiety discharging somebody as it gives you to talk about the discharge process.
Well, is it anxiety because you think that they won't be able to manage, or is it just anxiety because you know that you really, like, I did my thing with this one. Like, they going to be straight.
They going to be okay.
I do get they're going to be okay, but it can be stressful. As like, are they going to be okay? Are they going to continue to make the same decisions? And yes, like, I do feel there's sometimes where, as it was said earlier, we have 8 to 9 clients a day. There's some where I look forward to them coming. I'm like, oh, yes, like, I'm excited for this person to come. Yeah, and so, yes, like, genuinely, I have missed clients.
Yeah. And adding on to that, for me, you have to get to know someone else all over again. So that relationship that I developed for 3 years, I got to discharge
a brand new person in that spot.
And I got to get to know this person.
Yeah, that waitlist is not picking.
After a while, my therapist... my therapist would know. He's like, okay, so who did you beat up this week? It's like, how do you know? He's like, because I know you. You know, mm-hmm. I already know you.
So it goes back to that you have created a relationship with that person.
Yes. Irrespective of race and or culture. Like,
mm-hmm. Right, and then you lose it because they no longer come back because you have to release them.
Yep.
So you know,
we have... Go ahead.
For either of the mental health professionals on the call, has there ever been a time when you started out with somebody who just was like, I don't think you can help me. You're culturally different. You don't look like me. And I know that there are times when you just have to say, okay, we need to put you with somebody else. But were there times when you broke through?
I did that recently. Mm-hmm. I had she was 16, a young Black girl. She loved art, and I'm throwing that out there because I'll get to that. But she came in, and she, first thing out of her mouth, she sat down, slumped her arms. She said, I don't do therapy. And I said, okay. So I clicked my pen back, closed my book, and I said, I don't do wasting my time.
Mm. Okay.
And she just looked at me, and I was like, okay, let's go. Like, you're done. You're not going to waste my time. So she sat there for a second and stared at me. I have one tattoo, and I just so happen to have a short sleeve shirt on that day. She goes, I like your tattoo. I said, oh, thanks. But I continued to pack up my stuff.
Right.
Then she was like, oh, you have a pretty cool piercing in your ear. And I said, oh, so you're liking the artisticness. She said, yeah, I love art. She talked to me
the
entire hour.
There we go.
Boom. Boom. Yep. Something in common.
And now she loves me.
Race aside.
Yeah, literally. I mean, I don't think at that aspect it was race because she was in an office where I didn't have any pictures. Okay. So she didn't she didn't know what my husband looked like or my baby.
Okay.
Well, that's good.
It was literally
so you broke through without it.
I don't do you wasting my time. There's a wait list and there's people out there in that waiting room that want to be seen. So I'm not going to sit here and stare at you for an hour. Let's go. I will bring you back to your mom and say, now's not the time for her to have therapy.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then Nisi, like,
what about you?
I actually had an Indian child. He was
Indian from India or Native American?
Indian. No, he was Indian from India.
From India. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And he came to my group home at the time. And when I say broken in every sense of the word, and when I say it came from up top, it was the mom was bringing cigarettes and marijuana to it was terrible.
Bad.
And the issue he had was, let's say I had 8 boys in the home, 7 of them were African American.
Okay.
He was a target. Mm-hmm. He was a target.
He was a target.
But I was that person that when I came into the unit, I was almost a protection, and that protection lasted when I wasn't there because I was the person that came in and made it not okay.
Right. Right.
So he was able to, even though I wasn't, you know, too familiar with his culture. And so for me, when I have clients that I'm not familiar with, I like to go and do some research.
Right.
I know about my people. I know a little bit about white people, just a little bit, but if I'm not familiar, because I don't want to offend anyone.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That's my biggest thing. Do not offend. So being able to have that little boy actually gravitate towards me and me be his like saving grace, it meant a lot. I think that's what kind of put me in his direction.
Okay.
So yeah.
Okay.
Indian.
Well, you know what I believe? I believe this wholeheartedly, and I've said this in other podcast episodes, that if you take the time, even if you don't Google it, if you just say, well, tell me what that is or what that's like for you culturally, maybe something that they eat or
teach me something
that you will find that we are so more alike than we are different.
Mm-hmm.
So unfortunately, in the mental health field, there are actual systemic policy-driven disparities in care and access for whites versus non-whites. Let's just put it that way. You know, again, part of it is socioeconomic. A lot of it is cultural stigma. And I just, part of this discussion is to try to help people understand that it's okay to talk about not being okay.
Mm-hmm. Even if your family says,
stop
to keep your mouth shut
yep.
and don't tell anybody.
Absolutely.
you know. Yes. Even if you've grown up with that, because I know, you know, at our age, we've heard that a lot, and you get the look. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, don't you dare.
Right, right. Don't dare say
my own mother said the word shrink the other day.
And I was shrink. Like, shrink. Nobody says that.
Really?
I haven't heard that in years.
My own mother.
Because I had an older lady. This lady had been maybe 70-something years old. She came in my office one day, looked me in my face and said, oh, you can't help me. I said, oh, I can't. I left, sat back in my chair. 2 hours later, the lady walked out and said, can you make me an appointment for the next few weeks with that young lady? My supervisor came to me and said, Miss Peaches don't trust nobody. What did you say to Miss Peaches to have her come back? I'm me, baby. That's
when you have that charisma, right? Yeah. Let me see, I have that charisma. Yeah.
When you when you can build that relationship with people, like, you know, this is what you're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Jack can definitely attest to that. When you can build these tough relationships and make them stick and last, that matters so much to us.
Mm-hmm. I think we always hear about the bad things of everything, right? Mm-hmm. We don't hear, you know, always the good stories about and positive things. The fact that you guys chose the job that you chose, just like teachers, just, absolutely, you know, I think it says a lot about who you are. You're willing to help anybody, you know, they be Black. I think it's very, I would like to think that there's a small percentage that might have an issue, but then they work in a predominantly Black community, or they would work in a predominantly White community, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, mm-hmm, you wouldn't necessarily run into them. But I think, you know, when it comes to therapy, especially when you're talking about clinics and, you know, the jails, you have to be open to all different kinds of cultures, races, ethnicities. Mm-hmm. You know, the fact that you guys do your homework is a beautiful thing, because maybe, you know, we need to do a little more than, you know, a lot more therapists and social workers should do the same thing, you know, so that they can become more relatable and say, I know you might not trust me, but guess what? You know, I know about this. I know about that, because it's definitely, you know, when you have 5 minutes with a therapist in the beginning, you know, it's a scary thing. And like I said, if you're in there because you have distrust, or you have, you know, a lot of traumatic issues that you're going through, it takes a while to break down those barriers. You know, you guys got to be really good at what you do, and it's got to be mentally exhausting. Physically,
and it can't
exhausting.
Just be for a paycheck. These aren't jobs you do for the money.
No, it can't. Mm-mm. Just like teachers, they don't pay them enough, you know?
Yeah. No.
You can actually tell the people who are
not
here for
to,
a paycheck.
Not to,
I mean, it's
to bear the burden of 8 clients a day or an hour or however many people that you see.
Mm-hmm.
So we appreciate you for that. Just talk. We appreciate you. There needs to be more. I wish that the mental health profession, the field as a whole, was more diverse. I do. I think I think that there's a need for it. I think that when somebody is genuinely not comfortable with a therapist based purely on the fact that they don't look like them, there should be options.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Yes.
I agree. I think so.
I've never had Hispanic therapists.
I would love to see more men.
Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely more men. Mm-hmm. Definitely more men.
Especially, not for nothing, especially African American men, because African American men by far resist therapy. Mm-hmm. Like, it's taboo. You know, it's seen as weakness.
I have been seeing more and more becoming more comfortable with accepting that they may
I'm
need
so glad. I'm so glad.
Niecy and Jen, I have a question. Do you feel that the education that you guys received was enough when you went out in the field, or do you feel that there could have been something different that was taught to you that would have made it a little bit more, I don't know, better or easier, or?
Yes and no.
Yes and no, yes, okay.
You got to expand on that, girl.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. you know, we get the basic psych stuff, I'll say that. But you really don't learn the job, and I don't care what job it is, until you actually get on it.
Right.
Amen.
Everything I learned in the book was great, but for me, I felt like maybe it needs to be revamped. We need a new curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
The things that we learned in school now, they're not relevant to what we have going on during these times. Okay. Like, right. My therapy for me, I think, is a little different than a lot of people's method. Because we can't, like, I can't, a lot of things that we learn in school, we really can't apply to them in real life, realistically speaking. Jen may be able to give me a different outlook from her area, but from where I'm at, where I'm at, we can't go by the book. You go by the book, you won't, you'll lose your clients.
Wow.
Absolutely.
Do
you agree, Jen?
People like you when you're relatable.
They're like, don't share your stories. Don't share your life. Like,
oh, they tell you that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, me either. Mm-hmm. Me either.
I don't agree with that either.
I don't mind having my pictures up. And
yeah.
I mean, I...
Yeah. Would you agree that people relate to you, people take to you more when they feel like you're relatable?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, even with, like, high school, I've sat down on the ground and... You want to draw? Okay, let's go. Here's your paper. Here's mine. Like, I'm a horrible drawer, but you can
go down there and do what they're going to do. Yeah.
But I will say, to answer your question about the schooling, I learned more in a 6-month job at the local jail than I did in all 7 of my schooling years.
Wow.
You got to meet people at the point of their need.
Like, yep, that's a good way of putting it.
Yeah, you're like, when you're thrown into a situation, and again, the diversity piece of it, but I learned so much in 6 months at one place than I did in 7 years of college.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That you had to pay for.
Yeah.
Yep.
Right. Yeah. And probably still paying for it, right? There you go.
Oh, man. Oh, man. I'm going to pay till I'm 80, I think.
Yeah. I've been a stylist for like forever, so I'm the other therapist. I'm the other kind of therapist, by the way, in case you guys didn't. So,
can I tell you
I've heard
that
it all.
I do use my hairstylist as
I know you do. I do.
Like, getting my hair done and my nails done is my self-care, and I will literally, like, unload my life onto these people.
So if I sound like you guys, it's only because I'm a cosmetologist.
I say all the time, I'm like, you should literally have like a social work degree too, because you do exactly.
People don't give themselves enough credit. We are other people's therapists on a daily basis. When you go to work and somebody complains, you're a therapist.
Yes.
When your family member calls you, you're a therapist. When your daughter calls you, your son, you're a therapist.
Mm-hmm. I worked in a restaurant.
But the other part of that, Niecy, is I think we need to know when it goes beyond, like, they're just venting, and you need to be able to recognize that.
Oh, yeah.
You know what?
Agreed.
I hear you, and what I'm hearing is that, you know what? I know
more
this
help
dope
than me.
Therapist that you should probably talk to.
I got tagged in something for a therapist while I was on this podcast. Somebody was looking for a marriage therapist, and somebody tagged
me. Nice. Nice. Uh-huh. Here we go. See? We're just opening up the discussion. Candid. Yep. Discussions about mental health issues are a thing. They're a real thing, and people need to understand again that it's okay to not be okay.
And in order to get that, in order to get the help, right, we can't be as judgmental as we are. We have to be able to trust that this person is here for a reason. They have a degree for a reason. They've earned this degree to be put in this position in order to help me.
Right. And you know, stop
and
judging
the
them externally.
We have them hanging is to not show it off, but legally we're supposed to. So I just want to put that out
you're
there.
You're supposed to.
Yeah. Like, I'm not going to sit here and be like, oh, I have everything from my schools and my license hanging on the wall because I want you to see it.
Right.
I kind of wish it wasn't there.
I recently had to hang up all my stuff. Transparency. Listen, transparency, vulnerability, it's huge. People a lot of times are ashamed to just say that they, you know, sometimes I hear voices and nobody else hears them.
Right.
You never know. When I worked at the group home, one of my clients, they would always feel some kind of way because they had court cases. 16 and younger, guys.
That's tomorrow, but go ahead.
What I'm getting to is they did not understand and respect me until I actually told them that I can identify with what they were going through. And once I broke down how what my situation was worse, they respected me and it gave them something to work towards.
Right. Mm-hmm. There you go. Mm-hmm. Because, okay, if she went through this and she's here,
right,
it's possible for me. Mm-hmm. Got it.
Yep.
You know, I don't think there isn't... I think people have the ability, just because I didn't go through it, there's a general feeling, and if you're empathetic.
Empathy.
I might not have gone through the same exact thing, but I can literally be in your shoes and feel the frustration. I understand why you're frustrated. Yep. I understand why you can't sleep.
I don't have to have fallen off of a 16-story building to know that it hurts. It's going to impact me some way. So you don't have to go through every single thing that a client goes through to be able to empathize. That's a good word.
I want everybody to have empathy, to understand that when somebody is in a critical state, they start making excuses of why they don't want to let go of things too, right? So their job is a lot harder. You know, I'll make plenty of excuses. And I find that those are excuses, like, because you're white, you can't help me. Because you're black, you can't help me.
Right.
No, it's because you really don't want to sit here and get everything out. Because sometimes you feel like you're in limbo. And usually when you're holding on to these things, that means that you have some type of control, right? To give it to somebody else, you don't have that control anymore.
It's hard.
Right? And we have to learn how to be able to give that up to somebody, you know? Yeah. So the easier that, you know, the more that they're relatable, the more that, you know, we can see diversity, I think it'll make, you know, things a lot better for people to be able to go get the help, you know?
Yeah.
You know, it's a fine line. It really is.
It is. And every client is different, and you have to approach, you know, not just culturally or racially or ethnicity wise, but just period. Mm-hmm. This is a new person. Let me just see where they're at.
Yes. Do we have certain cultures that might suffer differently? I mean, that goes without saying. But you know what? Right. There's people that are poor of all ethnic backgrounds.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. There's adults that have lost jobs, whether it be male, female, black, Asian, Indian. You know, that really, when in logic, when you think about it, right?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Being hungry don't have no race.
No, right? It does not. You know. It doesn't, you know, it's really unrealistic to think that we would be the only culture that starves. That's not true. Right. In logic, that's not true. You know, we're not, you know, there's murderers, there's rapists, you know, the percentages might be a little higher than the other, you know, and another maybe, but they still exist. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. I think that while there are absolute racial disparities and ethnic disparities, I think they can be overcome with just a little bit more empathy and a little bit more understanding.
I think we become a little too egotistical to think it's just us. That's not reality. We're the human race, and you know, we have good and we have bad. You know, that's the yin and yang, right?
Right.
And all ethnicities, and I think we have our own opinions of white people. We have our own opinions of Asians. We have that's just human nature. If we can come together and let that crap go, you know, that would be a perfect world, you know?
Right.
But I don't know.
I agree. Well, y'all know what I'm about to say, right?
It's over.
Yep.
We are at our time, people. I'll be having problems even trying to post these things because they're saying it's too long. So, we are, you know, the places I be trying to post YouTube and stuff.
Oh man,
it's awful. They should just let us go ahead and rock out. I'm gonna start a radio station, and then I'm gonna be on, you know, at like for the morning drive and talk about this stuff while you're in the car. But
yeah,
that's the long term goal. But anyway. First of all, I want to thank Anise McGriff, Nisi to me. And I want to thank Jen. I don't know your last name, but Jen with the pink Converses.
Yes.
I really want to thank you, Kristen, too.
Where did you see us, Jen? Where did you come
across?
Did you?
Just on Podbean.
Nice.
Okay, cool. My husband got me on here. He's actually in a music podcast right now. So
nice.
Like, oh, join the podcast. I'm like, okay. So then I
all
just,
right, look at this.
Looking around. Well, and I'm like, oh, look, that's a
hope. Well, I'm glad you're not disappointed. And thank
I'm
you.
Glad.
I will be back tomorrow.
Yes. Oh, nice. So,
awesome.
You know, as we wrap up this part three in our candid discussion on mental health in minority and marginalized communities, I just want to again thank both of our mental health professionals, Anise McGriff and Jen Pink Converses. Until I learn your last name, you're going to be Jen Pink Converses. Okay. I appreciate you guys' input. It is, you know, it's amazing when you get a group of people together to talk about a topic and you have input. Jen is Caucasian and a social worker who sees clients from all from a diverse background. Anise is African-American who also sees clients from a diverse background. But the common thread was we do this job to help people, period, no matter what you look like, no matter where you come from. So I think that I'd like for more minority and marginalized communities to avail themselves of the help that's out there. Is it always proportionally the same for whites versus non-whites? No, but it's there. It's there. I don't like the wait list thing. We're going to do something about that. But before we go, because this is a mental health discussion, I need to give the, you know, the hotline numbers for somebody that might be listening or might hear this on a recording and be like, you know what? Mm-hmm. I think it's time for me to reach out. So here we go. National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, 1-800-273-TALK or 1-800-273-8255. Crisis text line is text NAMI to 741-741. Veterans Crisis Line, 1-800-273-8255 and then press 1 or text 838-255. For trans or anybody in the LGBTQ community, 1-877-565-8860. So if somebody is listening to this and you think you need help, you might not even be sure. But if you think you need help, then avail yourself of one of those numbers. Make a call. Shoot us a message. The Candid Shop is on IG, Facebook, Podbean, YouTube. You can find us. And we'll try to point you in a direction to get you the help you need. Tomorrow's episode, part four, is going to be mental health and minority and marginalized communities as it pertains to people 18 and under. So we're going to talk about the kids. And I hope everybody comes back and joins us. I thank everybody in the room.
I will be here.
Even if you didn't call in, if I see you in here, everybody out. I see y'all. I appreciate you joining this. If you could share it with your friends, your family, your social media, that'd be great. You know, the more followers we get, the more impact we can have, the bigger the platform to have these kinds of discussions. So
yes,
at the end of every episode, I always like to say what I want y'all to keep it safe, keep it healthy, and keep it candid. So we're going to see you guys tomorrow, 7 p.m.
I've been running low. I've been taking my time. I feel like I'm out of my mind. It feel like my life ain't mine. Who can relate? Woo! I've been running low. I've been taking my time. I feel like I'm out of my mind. It feel like my life ain't mine. The shit I'm talking about, they think they know it. I've been praying for somebody to save me. No one's heroic in my life. Don't even matter. I know it, I know it. I know I'm hurting deep down, but can't show it. I never had a place to call my own. I never had a home. Ain't nobody calling my phone. Where you been? Where you at? What's on your mind? They say every life precious, but nobody care about mine.